Ireland's a dream of hope and what the day will bring. The land and the sea is what I've come to trust. Reasons to live or fortune and fame for what it's worth. The reason to stay.
Hi, this is Andrea Cleghorn with Dispatches from Ireland. Today we're on Ireland's east coast, which is called the sunny southeast because it gets about half the rainfall of its neighbors on the west. We're in the town of Gorey in County Wexford, talking with Michael Dunbar, who directed a play this summer by Billy Roach, a Wexford playwright, called Belfry, performed for the first time in the Abbey Theatre in Dublin. At the first performance this summer, Billy Roach came himself to welcome the audience. Good morning.
Good morning.
Michael Dunbar, thank you so much for talking with me today. And
delighted to be here.
Tell me about your role at Gorey Little Theatre.
Well, I've been invited as a guest director at Gorey for the past 4 years for their summer season. They run a summer season in July and August every year because there is a large visitor population to the area, people coming down to their holiday homes, coming to the beach and coming to stay in the area. So they've been running this summer season for the past, I think, 52 years. And I just got involved in the last 4 years, and they invited me along. They sometimes select the play and ask me, would I like to direct that? I've directed two plays by Hugh Leonard, who is a noted Irish playwright, a play called Da and a Life, and also a play by an up-and-coming playwright called Dara Carvel, a play called Family Plot, 2 years ago. And this year I submitted a play by a local county man, Billy Roach, the play Belfry, and that's what I'm doing at the moment.
And can you tell us a little bit about Belfry?
Belfry is the story, I suppose, of Artie O'Leary, who is a sacristan. The play is set in a vestry and a belfry of a church. The stage is divided in half. And Artie is a very ordinary, man who goes about his daily life. Nothing very exciting seems to happen to him. He's minding his mother, who is ill. And suddenly he falls in love with the lady who does the flowers in the church. And suddenly his whole world changes, and because of that love affair he finds, I suppose, aspects of his own personality that he didn't know existed. And we find out through the play about his father who left when he was very young, and his mother just never speaks about him, and he doesn't really know very much about him. And it's also the story, I suppose, of the other four characters who inhabit the play. The lady Angela, with whom he has the affair, which changes his life. We hear her story. We meet her husband and how that we see a glimpse into their lives of maybe how their relationship is. There's also a young boy who has an intellectual disability and who works and helps out, and who Artie has befriended, and he works and helps out in the vestry and loves ringing the bells. And it's also his story, because he has kind of a tragic story too, I suppose, in that he comes from a very dysfunctional family who really don't accept him, and they want to put him into a special school. And we hear his story. And also then the fifth member of the cast is the priest, who is a young priest, I suppose. And we see him coming in and out of the story as somebody who is troubled, questioning his vocation, and I suppose, heading for a rather serious drink problem. So it's anything about them, but nothing is really resolved, or I suppose it's like real life.
It's part of a trilogy.
That's
that
right.
True?
It's part of the Wexford trilogy, which Billy Roach wrote. Billy's a Wexford Town playwright, grew up in Wexford Town, still lives in Wexford Town. But funnily enough, his trilogy of plays were first produced in London at the Bush Theatre in Shepherd's Bush. And it was part of what has now become known as the Wexford trilogy, only because there were three plays in a row by Billy, which the Bush took. A play called A Handful of Stars, then a play called Poor Beast in the Rain, and Belfry. And all three of them were very successful I'm talking now, the late 80s, early 90s, mm-hmm. at the Bush Theatre.
So there is, for people who don't know the geography in Ireland, Wexford is a county.
That's right.
And Wexford, there's a Wexford town.
That's right.
Also, and yeah. And Gorey is north.
Is in North Wexford. Wexford is the most is in the southeastern corner of Ireland,
mm-hmm.
and it's in the it's a, about an hour and a half south of Dublin. Stop me if I go off on a tangent.
I will. Love the tangents. Can you make a generalization about Irish plays versus American plays?
I'd like to think that I knew enough about them that I could. I suppose for the great American playwrights like Miller and O'Neill and people like that, I suppose, tackle that whole idea of the American dream, mm-hmm. and what it is to live in America, and I suppose what the, you know, the aspirations of the immigrant coming and becoming successful and what is success. And they, well, that to me is what is challenged. And I suppose mm-hmm. with O'Neill, he challenged, I suppose, his own family, I suppose, in maybe his greatest play, Long Day's Journey, in Tonight. He kind of, I suppose, minds and examines and analyzes the very dysfunctionality of his family. And I suppose, in many ways, as I say this, I suppose maybe some our writers in Ireland, I suppose, echo that. I mean, Hugh Leonard, as I've just mentioned, certainly minds his family for it. The playwright and novelist who currently working, Sebastian Barry, also kind of mind his own and seemed to work out his own family through writing plays and novels about them. I suppose Irish playwriting hasn't yet had. We've had many great playwrights going back to O'Casey, and mm-hmm. I suppose O'Casey, I suppose, a bit like Miller in a totally different genre, I suppose, tackled the big issues of, for Ireland at the time, of what is nationalism. Maybe Miller was tackling mm-hmm. what it is to be American and what is success. O'Casey looked at these three big plays, began to look at what's the cost of nationalism? What's the cost for ordinary people?
Mm-hmm.
What's the cost of war on the ordinary people of Ireland?
And the concept of family, the loyalty, the traditional values, the obligation to the other siblings, the whole culture, and also the Catholicism.
Yes, I think that's absolutely true. I suppose it's also to do with the geographical size of Ireland, you know.
In what way?
Because, you know, people in Ireland don't move with, they tend to stay within their, you know, relatively speaking, within their own communities, unless they emigrate to England or America or something, but they normally come back. And also Ireland is, you know, it's only, no matter how far you travel here, it's only 3 or 4 hours, and you reach the sea. So, and as we often say, you know, you can't go anywhere without meeting somebody that you know.
Whether
you like it or not. Not a great place to have an affair, I don't think. I think that is very true, and I think it is exactly as you said. I think it's bound in with Catholicism and the whole, and I think very much so. And we've evolved a kind of an Irish form of Catholicism that I think is, well, to me, this is only my opinion, it has, you know, almost, I think, influenced very much by the kind of the English Victorian era that was kind of mixed in with Catholicism mm-hmm. and became very authoritarian. And yes, it had, and that is very, and the family was put front and center, and those people were made to feel, I suppose, that the family unit was all important. And I would say that that's endemic, and I'd say is within almost every Irish person, that sort of the call of the family, the call of the tribe, I suppose, or whatever, you know, that very primal thing of being very attached. I grew up in a very small village.
And where did you grow up, Michael?
I grew up between Ferns and Wexford, about 10 miles away, in a place called Ferns. And it was great, but I mean, it was like, you know, people say, you know, it takes a village to rear a child. Well, you know, if we strayed off, you know, and we were you know, as children would run off and play outside the village somewhere, you know, if we were late, somebody on the street would say, your mother is looking for you, you know, and everybody would know, you know. And if you did something wrong, it, you know, my mother would know. If we did something naughty and we're robbing an orchard or something, my mother would probably know by the time we got home.
And it was homogeneous enough so there were similar values.
Yes.
Right?
Absolutely. Yes. That because, and particularly at that time, I think, I'm not saying Ireland is a classless society, nowhere is that, but I think everybody was more or less within the same sort of upper to lower middle class, if that's, if that's, you know, if you want to label people. But so yes, it was a very homogeneous, and also almost everybody at that time attended church regularly. Everybody, you know, we saw everybody. You went to the local school. Lots of families were intermarried, related. A lot of, you know, you were in a place where your cousins lived, where, you know, your aunt lived, your uncle, you know. And Ireland had, at that time, had very large families. I mean, I went to school with people who had like 12, 13, 14, 15, 16 children. I mean, these very large, I come from a family of three. I mean, it was very unusual.
Considered tiny.
Tiny, very unusual to have only three. I mean, most people had four, five, six, seven, eight children. You
know? Right.
So you can see that it's there's a kind of a, I suppose, in many ways, it, you know, it has very positive things. I mean, it's very nurturing and loving when it's all going well. It's only just when things become difficult or whatever, it's a tangled web to kind of, you know, to free yourself from sometimes, I suppose. You know, if your family structures go wrong or relationships break down because you're in a very small community, it's very hard to get away from it.
Next, I'll be talking with Michael Dunbar about the effect of the boom time in Ireland known as the Celtic Tiger. It started in 1994 with heavy foreign investment and a housing bubble that resulted in changes nationwide, all of which came to a crash in 2008.
The Celtic Tiger, I suppose, built up huge expectations within the community, within the country. People's aspirations, people's financial situations to be getting. People were, you know, the banks were throwing money at people. They were buying second houses, third houses. And then when it all crashed down, it was like this incredible rug being pulled from under.
And that was 2008.
That was 2008. Uh-huh. And I don't think the country hasn't really recovered totally from that yet. I think psychologically we haven't recovered from it because everybody's very wary. I think what it did too was it for a younger generation of people, it sent them in a huge wave of emigration abroad again. I mean, we have a huge amount of Irish people now, including my own son, who's like teaching in Dubai. An enormous amount of Irish teachers working in Canada, Dubai, Australia, New Zealand, who just left the country because, you know, there were no jobs. You know, we're finding it hard now to rebuild the building industry because so many people who were in the construction industry emigrated and left when everything collapsed. So it's and I think the psychological scar, I think, is huge because it's made an older generation almost feel guilty for maybe, you know, squandering and believing in a banking system and in a whole economy, and it's left a younger generation who can't afford to even buy a house here at the minute. In Irish theatre, we've had a lot of new playwrights who are addressing new issues. I think it took them time after the Celtic Tiger. It took playwrights a time to really understand and really get a sort of a handle on the national psyche or how people felt about it. We're getting a lot of docudrama now by people like Colin Murphy, that are kind of like documenting dramatic form the collapse of banks, what happened during the Celtic Tiger, analysing, you know, so the fall of Anglo-Irish Bank, which was a huge banking sort of institution which failed and which went into bankruptcy, bringing a lot of distress to a lot of people. They're doing that. Then there are new playwrights who are dealing with young... at the moment, I suppose, the most pressing thing that's happened is that the change or awareness, maybe is the better word, is called Waking the Feminists, which was the Abbey Theatre. The Abbey Theatre had a programme for their centenary a couple of years ago. And when it was looked at by a lot of people, it was seen that there was only like one or two female playwrights who were included in the programme of the Abbey. And so there was a huge outcry. There was an enormous movement called Waking the Feminists, led by a lady called Leanne Bell and many of the foremost directors and writers in the country. And it has evolved a huge awareness of that sort of awful gender bias that I don't think even theatre directors even were aware that they had it. They just didn't even, you know, that a lot of female playwrights were just not getting the same, female directors, female lighting designers and set designers and everybody else. So now I think that movement has been hugely successful. It has influenced the programming at the Abbey now hugely, at the Gate, in Druid, in all the big theatre companies. Mm-hmm. So, and I think that's a very good thing. I'm not saying we have absolute gender parity in everything. Now we don't, but I think there is more. Nobody will make a decision without thinking about that again.
Mm-hmm. And who are the major female playwrights now, would you say?
The major female playwrights would be people like Marina Carr. Uh-huh. She wrote plays like The May, which is soon going to have a new production, Portia Coughlin, By the Bog of Cats, Ariel, that dealt with By the Bog of Cats, for example, is almost like an Irish retelling of the Medea myth, mm-hmm. but in a very Irish, rural Irish context. Mm-hmm. It's about a woman scorned by her husband, who actually murders her daughter. Marina Carr, Deirdre Kinahan, a girl called Lisa O'Neill, is a new playwright and has a play that's been commissioned by the Abbey, which is now is touring the country. It's called Asking for It. It tackles rape and consent and what is consent with mm-hmm. and that whole debate about and it's very successful. It's coming to the Abbey later in the year.
I think if Americans, if I can speak for all Americans, were to name one theater in Ireland, they would think of the Abbey.
Of course.
And is that the oldest theater in Dublin, or is it the most longest running? Or
I'm not able to say that it's the oldest. Mm-hmm. to be honest, but why it's so famous? It was the first, I think, ever established national theater.
Okay.
It was established about 1902-03-04 mm-hmm. by the playwright and poet W.B. Yeats and his friend Lady Augusta Gregory. She lived over in Gort, County Galway. She was a kind of of the landed gentry. She was also a playwright.
Cool.
Yes, exactly. And she was also a playwright as well. And they had formed a kind of the Celtic literary revival, which was sort of around the end of the 19th into the 20th century, and they formed the Abbey with say John Millington Synge would have been the player of the Western world would have been a part of that, and they formed it from like an amateur company. They had all the ideas and all the intellectual rigor and I suppose the academic side of it, but they didn't really have the theatre craft side of it. They went to these people in Dublin called the Fay Brothers, who were running a theatre company, and they formed a very small theatre there that became extremely successful. And of course they had Synge wrote for them first, and he put on the Playboy of the Western World. There was a riot one night because of in Dublin by the audience because somebody came on stage in a shift which was like a slip or something caused great offence, and then it moved on to into the 20s. Now, they had many other playwrights, but the most famous, Sean O'Casey, came along in the 20s, who wrote his trilogy of Plough and the Stars, June and the Peacock, Shadow of a Gunman. They again, the Plough and the Stars, caused huge controversy again because of how scathing, I suppose, O'Casey was of some of the people who were the heroes of the 1916 Rising, and he certainly wasn't making them into any heroes. He was saying, look at what you did to the poor, you know, so, right. and how it affected them.
When you say it was the first national theatre, did it get national funding?
Yes, it did. It did. And I think in that way it became unique. And it evolved, I suppose, what they call the Abbey style. There was a certain genre of play that was performed there, which became rather tired over years, but that was like what they began to call the kitchen sink drama. It was always about sort of the family and what was happening by, and that was because of varying sort of artistic directors of the time who would have, you know, kept a certain genre of theatre, and that they would have decided was what, you know, was edifying and what was. Whereas O'Casey left them because O'Casey, who having been incredibly successful with his trilogy, he began to become much more expressionistic, and he was influenced by that kind of whole European movement of kind of expressionistic drama that was happening in the 30s and 40s. But the Abbey didn't want to know about it because they were too strange, too surreal, too weird. While the irony of that was that you had people like George Fitzmaurice, who wrote for them in the early years, who was incredibly surreal and wrote very unusual sort of plays. Funnily enough, now we have two Scottish guys who are now the joint artistic directors of the Abbey. It's the first time a non-Irish person has ever been, and they, I think, are doing a great job, in my opinion, of opening and, I would say, letting the wind flow through the Abbey. They call, you know, it's not just, and they've premiered shows all over the country because they feel it's a national theatre, so it should be seen nationally. It's not just a building, it's not just an institution.
Sort of the off-Broadway idea.
Exactly.
Right, before it's...
Exactly.
I've talked with Michael Dunbar about theatre in general, and in this final segment, we'll get down to how he got into the business, starting out with a childhood in a town called Ferns, just a few miles south of the town of Gorey, where the theater is.
So your family?
My family. I grew up in a family of three in a pub, strange enough. Lots of pubs in Ireland, in a village called Ferns. My father was a publican. He was also a local councillor on the local county council, very involved with the Labour Party and Labour Party politics, which... were seen as somewhat suspicious at that time.
And what was the Labour Party called?
It was called the Labour Party.
Oh, it was?
The Irish Labour Party, yeah. It was formed by one of the leading members, would have been James Connolly, who was one of the 1916, you know, people who led this. He was a Scottish man, but he formed the Irish Labour Party. My father was very involved in local politics. My mother was local, came from the local area. Her father was a guard.
A guard as a policeman?
As a policeman, yeah.
Yeah.
And he was a guard. I grew up, I had a wonderful childhood in a small village. I have one older brother and one older sister. And it was great. And they were very sporty. And everybody was, lots of Irish people were very involved in the GAA and hurling and football and... My sister went on to be a teacher, as I did, and my brother took over the business at home. He still runs the...
Oh, he does?
He does, yeah.
And what is that called?
It's called Dunbar's of Ferns.
Okay.
And it's the oldest license in County Wexford, I think, in the same name, because it's my great-grandfather established the pub back in 1840 something, and it's still in the same, it's still in the family name. But it was great, and growing up in a pub is a great place to go because you meet everybody, and we worked in the pub growing up, and you meet, you know, my father used to say, you know, everybody should have to work in a pub because you learn to meet everybody from every social class and every, you know, conceivable, you know, visitor, and everybody would land in the pub, and there was lots of talking and people discussing
stories,
absolutely. So it's full of story because people come in when they're happy, when they're sad, when they're celebrating, when they're grieving, when they're whatever. So you hear the stories of their lives, and you're for you know, fractions of their lives, you're part of it in the pub because the family come together and to, as I say, celebrate or commiserate or whatever it is. And so it was great. And so you met lots of people. It made you very sociable because you always had to be able to go out and just, you know, work behind the bar. And, you know, my mother wouldn't ever allow anybody to, you couldn't read behind the bar because that was rude. So even if it was quiet, you were told, you must speak to the customers. You must start a conversation and, you know, talk to them and be polite. People don't come in here to, you know, they come in here to be served and to be entertained. So, you know, by the people. So that was great. Then I
can I interrupt you for just a second? Just describe the pub, your family pub.
It's a very old building. If you see it, if you drive into the village from Gorey, from the north side of the, you see it on the corner. It's an all exposed stone. It's a small, warm, cozy. It has a fireplace. It has an old, you know, fanners, you know, that was a thing for, it was like a wheel for blowing the for keeping the draft on the fire there. And it has, now it has kind of many nooks and crannies. It has a little room up there that, you know, a little room off the bar.
Did you have a snug?
Oh, we always had a snug. And the snug, what I remember the snug growing up was, ladies didn't drink didn't come into bars. In Ireland, I would say, now I'm being very general, probably very pejorative here, but I would say before maybe the 1970s. But there were always some ladies who came to the bar, but they would go to the snug.
And what is a snug?
A snug was just a little tiny room, and it was like, it would be maybe only 6x4 or quite small, maybe with one or two tables and some chairs, and it would have a door that would be closed. It was like, so they went in there because.
But it also had a window.
Yeah, it had a window. Some had a window into the bar or maybe outside, but some of them were very small. I mean, I've been in them where they didn't have windows. They were just like little.
But I'm cubbios. Not talking about getting the refreshment.
Oh yes, well I mean, they were in our bar. We would have to serve them because we would know the ladies who went in, these ladies, particularly they would come into France, they would live out the country and they would come in on their bicycles and sometimes I'm old enough to remember even people coming in with donkey and carts and they would park in our yard and they'd do their shopping and then they'd come in and they'd have two drinks. Usually the ladies drank things like port. Mm-hmm. Or maybe something like a half glass of Guinness, and they would be served. They just go in there, and you know, we'd know they were there, and we'd go in there and serve them. But they wouldn't come out into the main bar.
And it wasn't until the 70s.
Yeah, in Ireland generally, I would
really?
Say it was the event of what they called the lounge bar. Every pub in Ireland, my mother and my father had died at this time, but my mother in the early 70s built a lounge onto the back of the bar, and it became the lounge was where, you know, a husband and wife or, you know, the lady, that was much more comfortable. It wasn't sort of like, you know, spit and sawdust or whatever and wooden chairs and stools. It was much more comfortable. And
right.
So it was somewhere you were kind of attracting, you know, people who are courting and people, but very much, and then there would be music, you know, in the lounge and stuff. So
would you have music in the pub itself?
We didn't always. We would have occasionally. We
yes.
wouldn't.
And would it be spontaneous?
Oh
or
yeah,
was
lots of lots
invited
of,
or hired.
Absolutely, lots of spontaneous.
Yes.
Of people who would come and play music and sing, and then sometimes there would be organized sessions where, you know, where there was going to be a party and people would come and they'd bring in hiring musicians
right.
and all that.
And is there when I first started coming to Ireland, I was told that the etiquette is if you want to talk to people, you go up to the bar
yes.
where the stools are or stand.
Yes.
You stand, and if you want to be
Listen.
By yourselves, you sit at a table.
I'd say that's pretty true, yeah. Because
yeah.
I think that's true. Because if you sit at the table, people kind of think, well, that's where you know you want to kind of stay to yourself or read
yeah.
your book or talk to your, you know, your husband or wife or your friend or whoever you're with. But if you go to the bar, it's kind of the talk is more free flowing and people, tend to kind of eventually include you in the conversation if you want to be, and people, and yeah, lots of people, I'd say that's true. Standing at the bar is where the action is, and now they say it happens in the smoking areas, now that there's no smoking in Irish pubs.
And when did that happen? Maybe 15 years ago, 10 years ago?
Yeah, gosh, I should know about that.
A lot of them still smell very smoky.
Yeah.
Right?
But they... I was amazed that Ireland adapted the smoking ban so readily. I mean, but then now people who don't even smoke go to the smoking areas, like to be, as they would call
that's
it...
That's where the action is
among, out there for the crack, as Irish people would say.
Right.
You know? And that's not it's not a substance, it's just a... It's
right, C-R-A-I-C.
Exactly.
Usually in italics.
Exactly. But so that has changed, that has changed Irish pubs to a large extent, I think, because, a lot of people who smoke, they will gravitate out there, and it can sometimes divide the company, you know, since then. But it did adapt very well to it. I was surprised because Irish people are not usually very compliant. They're rather anarchic about most things, you know. So
iconoclast.
Yes,
really.
Absolutely.
Really.
Yeah.
So getting back to you moved out of the family.
Yes, I went to
home, and you went to college.
I went to college in Dublin, and then I came back. I got a job as a teacher working at a special school for children with intellectual disabilities.
Uh-huh. Was that in the Gorey area?
In Enniscorthy.
Oh, okay. Which is south of here, half an hour.
That's
would
right.
you say?
About half an hour south of here, and it was the school within the county of Wexford in this kind of geographical area that met the educational needs of children with moderate, severe, and profound intellectual
right.
disabilities. So I worked there for 35 years.
And that is also the setting of Colm Tobin's book, Brooklyn?
Indeed it is, yes. Colm Tobin is an Enniscorthy man, and he in many of his books, like even earlier books, like The Blackwater Lightship, for example, the geography of Enniscorthy is hugely, he tells about, how many steps there are up on to this footpath, and, as he describes, growing up and living there. Enniscorthy is, absolutely, inherent in all his work.
Right.
And
in fact,
and his family,
Castle,
family members still live there.
There's the set of Brooklyn, the
yes.
movie.
Yeah, he was thrilled that so much of, they actually made so much of the film in the town of Enniscorthy. He was thrilled with that. Yeah, in Castle Street, they used the old Athenaeum, which was the old hall where the dances would have been, where people would have gone to, in the 1950s. It was the local dance hall. That's still there, and they used that for the dance hall sequence. And in the street there, they just had to make it look a little more 1950s than it is now. But they didn't have to make a lot of changes at all.
That's what's so beautiful about it.
And they filmed, I think, what's her name? Eilish, isn't it? It's the latest, the star.
And she was played by
Saoirse Ronan. And they had her living in Court Street, which is our John Street, which is in a house which is still there. And they used all the outside shots were shot along there.
Right.
So it was great. And they filmed then in Coratloe, down on the nearby beach, which is beautiful, a beautiful stretch of beach. They also made that film Saving Private Ryan there.
Oh, really?
Yeah, they made that whole opening sequence of the D-Day landings. It was all filmed along Coratloe Beach because it has 13 miles of beach.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. So you're teaching, what we would consider special needs?
Yeah, children with special
children,
needs. Children?
Yes. For 35 years?
35 years. And I was always very interested in theatre. So midway through that, I got married and had children of my own. So it was we had mortgages and all those kind of things. So.
And how old are you, may I ask?
Certainly. I'm 60. I was 60 this year.
Congratulations.
Thank you. And I became involved with the local theatre group. I was very lucky in that there were a group of people around the town, more or less of my own age, who had a huge interest. One man had come from, he would have been a founder member of the Druid Theatre Company, which is a very famous theatre company in Ireland, who've toured internationally. But they were established in Galway by a group from the university who had gone to university there. And this man, Pat Connaughton, had come to work in Enniscorthy, but he had been involved with Druid, so he came to Enniscorthy with a dying to get involved with theatre. So we all worked together, and there's a very strong amateur drama movement in Ireland, very strong.
Right now, you mean?
Oh, absolutely, and has been for years. There are drama festivals throughout Ireland all through January through to Easter. There is a church influence there too. That it was a lot of priests and the church encouraged it greatly, of keeping people out of pubs during Lent. as a pursuit, but and so and there is an All Ireland drama festival, and it's a competition, and there are drama festivals throughout, and it's wonderful. It's throughout the 32 counties of Ireland, and there are festivals, drama festivals in like 30 or 40 towns, which you can compete at, and you compete at the All Ireland drama finals, which are held in Athlone, and then another section of the drama finals alternates around Ireland through the provinces to different venues. So you've got a lot of companies. So we got very involved with that, and then we were invited to perform.
You're saying we, you and
myself and a group of people who like-minded, kind of, I suppose, people who were, you know, passionate and obsessive about theatre. You know, we used to go. We talked about nothing else, or, you know, just going to plays and reading plays and trying to perform plays. Some of them in the initial stages very badly.
And were you acting?
We were acting. Yeah, acting. And
were you doing everything?
We were doing everything. We were acting. We were making the sets. We were, you know, painting them. We were finding the props at home and raiding everybody's houses and going and begging and borrowing from the local community for everything we could get. And we there was a group, I suppose, of maybe 10 or 12 people, and we worked very hard. Andy, who's in the play here, who's playing the lead in Belfry here in Gordon, he was one of that group that worked with me. And then I went on subsequently. I did a master's in theatre studies at DCU in Dublin. I've just had a lifelong sort of love affair with it. We were lucky enough to be able to compete on the amateur circuit in England as well, and we went over there to festivals and. We brought a show to the States one time, to Omaha, Nebraska, of all places, many years ago, to the conference of the American Conference of Irish Studies, and we performed a Brian Friel play there called Gentle Island, and so I've always been involved since then. As I say, amateur drama is very vibrant, very lively in Ireland. There's a great audience for it. There is a huge kind of national community of people who are deeply involved in theatre, and the festivals are great, and they're socially, they're also great.
I think that's that is our perception as Americans, I think, of the Irish just being very involved in the arts. I mean, whether it's writing or acting or
music,
great audiences. So have you written a screenplay?
I haven't. I have to say, I would love to think I had the ability to write. My friend Andy has written a play that we performed.
Oh, you did?
That we performed some years ago, called Something About Roses. But no, I haven't. I don't think my talents lie in the writing area. I have great admiration, and I think I'm in awe of writers, really, you know. I love to interpret their work, but I don't think I have the skills to actually write. I've tried, but we'll see. I don't know.
Might be fun for you.
Maybe.
To do that. So what's next for you, Michael?
What's next for me is I've been very involved with another local community drama company in Carnew, which is another village about maybe 8-10 miles. Here in County Wicklow, just near Gorey here, and I've been directing musicals with them for the last 12 or 13 years, and in September we begin My Fair Lady, so I'm looking forward to that, and that's a huge community event in a wonderful community up there. I think Carnew must be one of the. I mean, to mount a musical costs a lot of money, and they're quite a small community, but they're a wonderfully supportive and hardworking community who are.
How about national funding for the arts? How is that in Ireland?
I would suffered badly to the Celtic Tiger. Uh-huh. The amateur art are very badly supported. Uh-huh. Professionally, it's getting better. There is a there all arts funding comes through the Arts Council, which is a government body. Uh-huh. And all companies, all theatre companies, all musicians, all writers, anybody who paint, be they artists or whatever, sculptors, whatever, they can apply for funding to the Arts Council. Mm-hmm. And it's within the remit of the Arts Council then to
is it federal funding through the
yes,
communities?
It is. Uh-huh. Yeah, it's from the government. The Arts Council get a budget, and they have a large committee, and they decide how this money is distributed. But you submit your project or your uh-huh. whatever, and that's
I meant to ask you earlier, did you cast Belfry, the play, yourself?
Oh, yes.
Did you?
Oh, yes. I think directors have to cast, really. I mean, because it has to be your vision of the play. So, oh, yeah, absolutely, yes. Uh-huh. Yeah, yeah. I feel you have to, unless when somebody comes into audition, it has to be what you think. Yes, they seem to be in the interpretation of the character that I would like. Maybe somebody else might take a different view, and that's fine. But I think it has to be your vision of what you think it should be. So I would feel strongly, yes, the director has got to cast it as he or she sees it.
All right. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Talking with us today.
It's been delightful. Thank you.
Ireland's a dream of hope and what the day will bring. The land and the sea is what I've come to trust. Reasons to live, or fortune and fate for what it's worth. Reason to stay is heaven. Brothers are ten, sisters I find. Four in one bed, there's room enough to grow. And all that we are is all that I've ever known. And all that I have would be here when I'm gone. Reasons to live.